Well, here we go again. It's another full English. I have just had some delicious beans on toast, and I'm raring to go. I hope they don't give me wind. Hi everybody, my name is Mr. Duncan, and I'm very chuffed to meet you. Welcome to episode 4 of my Full English series. Another delve into the wonderful world of English is about to take place. So, hold on to your hats and brace yourselves, as it's about to get a bit breezy round here. Yep, the wind is about to get up. So, prepare to be blown away. As you can see right now, it is very windy here. There is a gale blowing across England. What you are seeing now is the effect of what is left of a tropical hurricane. This is all that remains of the storm. We can describe this as the remnants, or all that remains of the hurricane. A few days ago, this storm was very powerful. It caused damage in places such as Bermuda. Now, it is not as powerful. Having said that, the storm is still strong enough to bring down trees and loosen one or two roof tiles. Some might say that I'm taking a risk coming out here on such a stormy day. Let's hope that I don't get struck by a piece of flying debris or a falling tree. Knowledge is a great thing, not to mention useful too. However, it is not possible to know everything. There just isn't enough time to learn everything about everything. Not to mention all the effort involved in learning all of those things. I can safely say that there are things I know little about. I certainly don't know everything, although I do focus on certain subjects. Specialist areas of knowledge tend to be stored by those in that particular field. In this sense, the word field is the area of expertise. You are an expert in that particular field. There are many subjects that a person can be an expert in, and many other fields exist in each subject. For example, the field of science covers many subjects, as does history and language. I always say that while it is impossible to know everything, it is still possible to be interested in many things. Learning something new can lead you to explore and discover many other things. As I always say, a head full of knowledge can go a long way. So learn something new every day.
birdie birdies, birdie birdies, birdie birdie birdies, where are you?
Can you see what I have in my hand? It's a plate of bread. I'm going to leave this bread out for the birds. Birds like eating bread. However, it is important to first dampen the bread with water before putting it out, or else the bread may swell up in the bird's throat and choke it. This bread has been soaked in water. It is soggy. When something becomes soggy, it means that the water is soaked into it. Clothes can become soggy. If something can absorb water, then it can become soggy. Sodden, wet through, mushy, squelchy, waterlogged. Okay, I had better put this bread out for the birds before they get angry and start pecking my eyes out. Oh no, my watch has stopped again. I had better wind it up. The word wind has more than one meaning. You can wind something up by turning and tightening it at the same time, such as the spring on a watch or clock. You wind the spring up. To gather something onto a round spool by turning it can be described as winding. You wind something on to something else. You can wind a hose pipe. You can wind wool into a ball. You can wind a person up. In this sense, you are doing something to annoy them. Then there is wind up. This noun describes a practical joke or prank designed to annoy someone. Another verbal use of wind is slowly end something, to close down a company or cease trading over a period of time is to wind up. To relax yourself by doing something pleasurable is to wind down. The past tense of wind is wound. Look at that, the writing on the wall. This figurative expression is used to state that something bad might happen soon. The fate of something is likely to happen. It is very apparent that this thing could occur. There is an indication that things could go wrong. The fall in profits is the writing on the wall for that company. In this sentence, we are saying that the company will go out of business if things do not get better. It may close. There is a chance that things might go wrong. It may be seen as foolish when told by all to ignore the hint and warning of the writing on the wall. Have you ever filled a niche? Don't worry, I'm not being rude. A niche is a word that describes a specialist area that you happen to fill. Your ability fills that exact need. Niche on its own means a place or area. It refers to an exact gap. If a person's profession relates to a specific task, then we can say that that profession fills a niche. You can fill a niche if your skill is especially useful in a certain field. The word niche derives from the French word for recess and the Latin word for nest.
Do you have a vice? Is there a guilty pleasure in your life? Is there something you have a weakness for? Mine is chocolate. I really love eating it. If there is a bar of chocolate in the house, I cannot resist taking a bite out of it. The word vice can also describe a wicked or immoral action. A guilty pleasure can be something you do without letting others know about it. Perhaps you enjoy watching a terrible reality TV show in secret, or a really bad movie. You will not admit to doing it, but when the chance comes, you actually do it. The thing you enjoy doing in secret is your guilty pleasure. Oh look, I have some chocolate here. Shall I eat some now? No. I'll save it for later.
Grammar covers many aspects of language use, including punctuation. When expressing yourself in writing, it is important to know where to punctuate and when to use the symbols that define it. One of the most confusing punctuation marks must be the inverted commas, otherwise known as quotation marks. There are two types of inverted comma, the single and the double. In British English, the single quotation mark is often used, while in American English, the double quotation mark is preferred. When quoting a well-known phrase or direct speech in a sentence in British English, we will normally use the single quotation. However, if the direct speech also includes a quote, then you will use the other quotation marks to define it from what is being said. If the direct speech uses single quotes, then the double ones will be used to show the quotes within. An example in British English would be, around here, we always use the phrase, no pain, no gain, as our motto. You will see that the direct speech has single quotes and the phrase discussed has double ones. In American English, this is reversed. You will notice in my subtitles that I use single inverted commas when I'm highlighting a word and double quotes when demonstrating direct speech. It is worth noting that you are free to use either of the quotation marks, as long as you stick with them all the way through the piece you are writing. The examples used here today are only a guide. Double quotes are fine for direct speech, or single ones, as long as you remain clear as to how they are being used. Happy writing, everyone!
Here are my lovely walking boots. Do you like them? These boots have taken me all over the place. Up hills and down into valleys. Through woods and over dales and dells. By the way, a dell is a small dip in the ground. A small valley or hollow. Did you know that the word boot has many meanings? As a verb, boot means to kick something hard. It can also mean to throw someone out of a place or eject a person from a group. He was booted out of the chess club. If you put the boot in, then this means that you are kicking someone, normally while they are on the ground. To be given the boot means that you have lost your job. In computer terms, the word boot means to start up a computer. On a car, the boot is the opening at the back where items can be placed securely. In American English, the boot of a car is called the trunk. Sadly, that is all I have time for today. I'm such a busy bee these days. I'm always rushed off my feet. I haven't a moment to spare these days. Still, it's nice to be busy, don't you think? I will see you all again soon for Full English number 5. Will you be there? I hope so. This is Mr. Duncan in the birthplace of the English language. Yes, of course, that is England, saying to you, stay happy and keep your chin up. Until next time. And of course, ta-ta for now. Don't forget you can catch up with all of my English lessons by clicking on the playlists. Learning English with Mr. Duncan. Ask Mr. Duncan. The Word Stop. And of course, my full English lessons as well. With all of these lessons, you will discover that the world of English is indeed a fun and exciting place to be.